last decade, not just last year. And so, happy New Year to you. Happy 2020, new decade as well. I invite you to turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16, and this is the passage that we were in last week. We're going to look at two other passages that we've been in previous weeks, and then fold it into some practical concepts that I want to set before you in this idea of 2020 vision. I'll invite you also to come back tonight. I'm going to start a series on the first 11 chapters of Genesis that will take us some time to work through, but Genesis is foundational to our faith, just the book of origins, the truth of origins. And so come to Sunday night worship if you are able. And then next Sunday morning, I'll start a series in the book of Philippians, and we'll walk right through the book of Philippians. I look forward to that. But this morning, we're going to think about this idea of 2020 vision. Now, at least to my recall, I can only remember one time being sent to the office in high school. Myself and another student were called from class the first semester of our freshman year for an eye test. Previous to that, I didn't have glasses. I didn't think I needed glasses. Well, that eye test would reveal to me that my vision needed corrected, that it had gone bad along the way, and that I needed glasses. Now, you can probably imagine that as a freshman, my number one concern was, well, what am I going to look like in glasses? Will I look silly? Will I look okay? But little did I know that that would actually change my life. And with vision correction, I began to see detail that I hadn't seen in a very long time. And 20/20 vision is a term that eye doctors use to express clarity of vision measured at a distance of 20 feet. And so 20/20 vision is what we want. It means that you see clearly at a distance of 20 feet what should be seen clearly normally at that distance. And I wonder, when we think about vision, how your vision of the church is. Do you see clearly what God's church is and what it's supposed to be doing? My bad vision came on over time, and I really didn't realize it until I took an eye test that exposed the problem and led to correction. And I found it to be very common for Christians, this even happened to me from time to time, that we can develop bad vision of God's church. It might be due to incorrect vision to begin with. Perhaps we never had a correct view of God's church, or perhaps it's a slow deterioration that comes on over time. But our goal this morning is to gain a clear vision of what God's church is, but also what God's church ought to be doing. And so to accomplish this goal, we're going to revisit three passages in Matthew from previous weeks to get a clear vision of what God's church is. But then we're going to take those concepts one step further and look to description in the New Testament for what the church ought to be doing. So let's start with a clear vision of what God's church is. Now, both of my kids have enjoyed working puzzles. Mason right now, our preschooler, requires those really big ones that you lay out on the floor, just has a few dozen pieces. Maddie, she's more advanced, and she can work puzzles that have hundreds, even thousands of pieces. But there's nothing more frustrating than nearly completing a puzzle, and what happens? You find there's one piece missing. Well, sometimes we can have missing pieces in our vision of God's church. And so to make sure that doesn't happen for those of us gathered today, I want to return to these three passages in Matthew that each define, each give description, definition to what God's church is, and take them together to gain a total and clear vision of what the church is. So first of all, I'll have you know that God's church is founded on Jesus Christ. It's founded on Jesus Christ. Look with me to our Matthew chapter 16 passage. This was the passage of scripture that we studied last week. It's where Jesus is talking with his disciples, and he asks them the question, "Who do you say that I am?" They gave some answers that represented what other people said, but he asked them the question, "Who do you say that I am?" And look in Matthew 16, verse 16. Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus responded, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, because flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I also say to you that you're Peter, and on this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. And so it's true to say that the foundation of God's church is the truth that Jesus Christ is the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Practically, this means that the character of Jesus and the authority of Jesus define what the church is and what she becomes. Secondly, I'll have you know that God's church is comprised of love. If you're tracking in your Bible, flip forward to Matthew chapter 22. Again, a passage that we've dealt with in previous weeks. God's church is comprised of love, and in Matthew chapter 22, Jesus is being asked, what is the greatest commandment? And look at what he says, or what is recorded beginning in verse 35. One of them, an expert in the law, asked a question to test him, "Teacher, which command in the law is the greatest?" And Jesus said to him, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the greatest and most important command. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All of the law and the prophets depend on these two commands." And so the composition of God's church is love. A love for God and a love for others. Now practically, and in response to God's amazing grace-filled love given to us through salvation, we then love God with our entire lives. And Jesus says as an extension of that, we love our neighbor as ourselves. Thirdly, regarding what the church is, God's church is engaged in mission. It's engaged in mission. Flip forward again to Matthew chapter 28, a third and final passage that we've dealt with previous weeks, known as the Great Commission. But in Matthew chapter 28, some of Jesus' final words to his disciples are recorded right here in verses 19 and 20. He says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and Son and Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I've commanded you, and remember I'm with you always to the end of the age." And so we see that the mission that God's church is engaged in is making disciples by going and baptizing and then teaching. Practically speaking, every Christian is to be engaged in this mission, both individually and corporately, through the context of God's church. So what is the total and clear vision of what God's church is? Well, simply these three things: that its source is Jesus, its substance is love, and its responsibility is God's mission. So with these three things nailed down, these three things solidified in our minds, let's go to the second aspect of what we're considering this morning regarding vision, which is a clear vision of what God's church does. Now, these days, kids' toys come not assembled together, but in 1,000 pieces, crammed in a very small box that caused mom and dad a whole lot of frustration, in fact, hours sometimes. But the ultimate end is joy once it's finished and the child can enjoy the toy. Now, it's a mistaken notion to think that the New Testament offers a step-by-step process for what the church is supposed to be doing, like an instruction manual would for a toy. Rather, what the Bible does is describe the things that the early church did to carry out the three non-negotiables that we just looked at. Those three things that the church is, the New Testament gives great description to show how they carried that out. In other words, what the church does. And these descriptions, as recorded in the book of Acts, the letters of Paul, pastoral epistles, really should serve as our model for what the church should be doing. And so I want to spend the rest of our time together discovering five primary purposes that the church should carry out. In other words, this is what the church does. Purpose number one is this: evangelism. With each of these five purposes, I'd like to name the purpose, but also give you a basic definition or description of that purpose. And so evangelism is the active calling of people to respond to the gospel of salvation by repenting of their sin and believing in Jesus Christ for salvation. This is what Jesus commanded in the Great Commission when he said, "Go." Mark 16:15 recorded it like this. It says, Jesus said, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. We see the apostles engage this mission after Jesus' ascension. We see Paul and his co-laborers engaging it through three extensive mission trips. We see all throughout the New Testament church leaders and lay leaders engaging it in their own context. And church, by extension, evangelism is a mandate and a purpose given to every Christian in every church. But the question becomes, well, how do we do evangelism? Let me suggest that we do evangelism, first of all, by giving. Here at Second Baptist, we engage in evangelism together by financially giving through our church to local and to national and to world missions. And so today we celebrate that we exceeded our goal to the Lottie Moon Christmas offering that sends thousands of dollars all over the world to real-life missionaries doing evangelistic work in places that do not know the gospel. And so we give. We give through special offerings. We give through our church budget. But also we do evangelism by praying. So we give and we pray. We pray for the evangelism efforts that we financially support. We pray for individuals and mission teams that we send all over our community and state and nation and world that go to do evangelism. We pray for our own daily obedience and engagement and influence in evangelism. So we give. Pray. And thirdly, how do we do evangelism? We go. Christians, every one of us, have the personal responsibility to actively convey the gospel and call people to respond to it by repenting of their sin and believing in Jesus Christ for salvation. And so this very thing is the reason that on my first Sunday as your senior pastor, I called us all to establish a Great Commission 3 list. A list of three people in our life that we can be intentional to pray for and build relationships with and further relationships with, all with an effort to minister the gospel into their life. And just as a side note, a focus of my efforts in leading our church into the future is going to be equipping us to effectively do that very thing, to convey the gospel and to call people to salvation. Going and doing evangelism is also why I strongly encourage you to become an inviter. There is still power in personal invitation. I could give you numbers all day long that say an exceeding amount of people that are invited to church the first time with a personal invitation will end up going. Oftentimes more than 75% of the time. And I promise that if you invite people to come to Second Baptist Church with you, they're going to hear the gospel and have opportunity to trust in Jesus for salvation. And then regarding going and doing evangelism, the most important place that each of us can go is to our own family and friends and neighbors. And when we go to them, we live a holy and godly life. We speak about our faith. We look for opportunities to love them. We invite them to church. We share our salvation story of how Jesus saved us. We tell them the gospel. It really is simple. It's just difficult in the sense that sometimes we're cowardly about it. Now, I want to note also that the purpose of evangelism is why I'm praying and planning for our church to be more recognized and ingrained in our community, perhaps than it ever has been before. I don't know entirely, to be honest with you, what that'll look like in the future, but through connections with local leaders, being involved in community events and activities, simply through loving and giving back to our community, I, and I hope that you'll join me, desire for our community to know the love of Jesus and have the opportunity to respond to his salvation invitation. The church, this will only come through real love and active involvement with those outside of our church. And so I want you to think for a moment. What if God were to bring a great harvest through our faithfulness to evangelism right here at Second Baptist Church? What if people in our community started to get saved, started to connect with our church? Will we be ready to welcome them and love them and walk alongside them? Will we be open to do practical practical things like offer an additional Sunday morning worship service to accommodate the numerical increase? Would we be open to doing new things with our church staffing, even updating our facilities to more effectively minister to people here in Marion and the surrounding community? Church, would you begin to pray now for how we will react to the harvest that the Lord might bring if we're faithful in obedience to the purpose of evangelism? But perhaps even before we pray for that, we ought to pray and ask ourselves the question, will we join our Lord Jesus Christ in being faithful to evangelism? There's a second purpose of what the church does that I'll have you note, and this second purpose is what we call fellowship. Now, growing up, anytime I heard fellowship, and we even at my church had a fellowship hall in which we did this, generally I thought of church potlucks or any event that involved food. But of course, biblical fellowship goes much deeper. And so fellowship is the bond of common devotion and purpose that binds Christians together and to Christ. I like to think of fellowship as doing life together with Jesus as our common core. We do life with one another, and the one thing that pulls us together, the one thing that we converge on together, is Jesus. So the Great Commission commands us to go, but it also commands us to baptize. We understand that baptism is, one, an initial act of obedience to God. Secondly, it's a symbolic expression of our salvation, but it's also a sort of welcoming a person into the body of Christ, the church. And the church is ground zero for Christian fellowship. Now we look at Paul's life and see that he enjoyed deep fellowship with fellow believers and as well as churches in the various cities that he ministered to. One example is his deep relationship that he had with Timothy and the heartfelt letters that he wrote to Timothy as both a leader and a brother in Christ. Another example is the quality time that he spent with the Ephesian elders at Miletus, as recorded in Acts chapter 20. But when we think about fellowship, we have to ask ourselves the question, what should fellowship look like in our church? Well, let me give a few suggestions. One is that we look not only to our interests, but also the interests of others. That we love our neighbor as ourselves. That we treasure our relationship with other Christians as the most valuable in all of our life. That we look for opportunities to engage with one another beyond just scheduled church times. That we use our Sunday school classes as opportunities to be known by others, but also to know others. That we genuinely care for others' needs, but also allow them to care for us when we're in need. And that we remain open with our fellowship, always allowing new people to come in and to do life with us. You see, God has created us for a relationship with others. It's how He's hardwired us. And that need is no more significantly met than in the context of God's church through real and genuine fellowship. But as with all spiritual purposes and disciplines, fellowship requires a great deal of intentionality and effort. It doesn't happen automatically, and I would even say that it requires great humility. Because when we do biblical fellowship, the attention won't always be on us. Oftentimes, most of the time, it's on others. But would you join me in asking the Lord to fan the flame of desire and passion for fellowship here at Second Baptist Church? The third purpose of what the church does that I'll have you note is the purpose of discipleship. The purpose of discipleship. And so the single aim of the Great Commission is actually to make disciples. Jesus says you're to go and make disciples, but the way you do it is you go and you baptize and you teach them. But what is discipleship? Discipleship is teaching everything God has commanded with the goal of others and ourselves becoming fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Now, in Paul's life, some of his missionary visits were very short, probably only allowing time to engage in evangelism, but other visits of his were long and resulted in significant discipleship. For example, many believe that Paul spent a combined length of 4.5 years with the Ephesians. Surely during that time he preached the gospel, he established churches, but it has to be true that a great deal of his time with them was focused on teaching the depth of the scriptures in effort to see the Ephesians become fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Paul also modeled personal seriousness about discipleship. To the Philippians in chapter 3, verse 10, he says, "My goal is to know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death." So Paul was fully invested in making and developing disciples out of others, but he was also very serious about growing as a disciple himself. Here at Second Baptist Church, through the preaching and teaching of God's Word, and through the fellowship of His people, and through the work of the Holy Spirit growing us up, we collectively and individually are transforming into fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ. Not only that, but I love the legacy of Sunday school in this church. Do you realize, though, that Sunday school offers prime opportunity for the accomplishment of two of God's purposes for His church, for discipleship and fellowship? I mean, in Sunday school, we study the Word together, but it's also a prime opportunity to know others and be known by them, to do life with Jesus as our common core. And so if you're a Sunday school leader, I would encourage you to think and to focus on engaging both of these purposes in your groups, discipleship and fellowship. And if you're not connected to a Sunday school class, I strongly urge you to do so for the very reasons that we've mentioned. And if you are connected to a Sunday school class, would you ask the Lord to stir your heart, but also stir the hearts of others for these purposes, for discipleship and fellowship? And would you personally be a catalyst for accomplishing? Just as a side note, Pastor Ashby and I have the desire to introduce different opportunities for discipleship in the future, of which we'll speak on more in the future. But I especially want to urge you to take discipleship serious on a personal level. Growth as a disciple might require more, but it certainly doesn't require less than regular prayer and Bible study and genuine fellowship with God's church. And if you're not engaged in these, there's really not much hope for personal discipleship growth. But the new year is a great opportunity to start, or even to continue, or to renew. Start in the New Testament. Read one chapter of the Bible each day. Choose a time each day that you'll pray even just for a few minutes. Decide now that you'll be at church not just occasionally, but every week, that you're not either out of town or sick. But if you desire to grow as a disciple, start somewhere. Start right now. Fourthly, I would have you note the purpose of ministry regarding what the church does. Ministry, as a definition, is the act of meeting the needs of others with love. And so in the Great Commandment, Jesus commands us, love your neighbor as yourself. Now, throughout the New Testament, relational and physical, emotional and intellectual needs were all met, not just by church leaders, but by one another within the church. And as Christians, isn't it true that we face all kinds of daily needs? It's also true that God ultimately meets all of our needs, and He exclusively meets our spiritual needs. But finally, it's true that we're surrounded with others in the context of the body, the church, so that we can love our neighbors as ourselves, by meeting each other's needs in love. This is a God-given purpose and responsibility. Ministry is really an extension of fellowship. I mean, if you think about it, when we know and are known by others, we're then positioned to meet relational and physical and emotional needs. And our pastoral staff is ready and available to minister in these ways, in whatever ways we can. Our deacons are ordained as servants to assist the leaders of the church in meeting the needs of the congregation. But also, each individual within God's church should be alert to the needs of others around them and be ready to meet those needs with love however they can. evangelistic love. And Jesus set the example in this area of meeting physical needs with the focus of also meeting their spiritual needs. So in this sense, ministry and evangelism work very closely together. But would you ask the Lord today to open your heart to a desire and a willingness to meet the needs of others, both inside and outside of God's church? There's a fifth and final purpose that I'll have you note when it comes to what the church does. That is, in light of what the church is from those Matthew passages, these five things are what the church does. Number five is worship. Worship is our appropriate human response to the majesty of God. And so, in light of all that God is, a definition of worship could be that worship is the adoration of God in action, in word, and thought. Now, it's common to think of worship as being identified with music and singing, and certainly it is that. That's part of worship. In fact, the Psalms are simply songs of worship and lament to God. But Jesus takes worship even a step further. And so in John 4:24, he says, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Paul modeled this, and he also commanded from Romans chapter 12, verse 1, saying, therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of the mercies of God, I urge you to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true worship. So while our worship services contain singing and prayer and preaching, worship is ultimately a lifestyle of obedience to God in action and word and thought. So we can sum this up by saying that we exist to glorify God and do His will. In other words, you and I, Christians, were made for worship. And so our goal this morning is to gain a clear vision of what God's church is and what it ought to be doing. So based on Matthew 16 and 22 and chapter 28, the things that God's church is that it's founded on Jesus, it's comprised of love, it's focused on mission. And based on description in the New Testament, God's church does these things: evangelism, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and worship. Church, this is 2020 vision of God's church. This is a correct, a normal view of what God's church is and what she ought to be doing. And in the power of the Holy Spirit, these principles and purposes should be what guide us here at Second Baptist Church. They should be descriptive and true of who we are, but also what we do. They should be the measure of what we measure our success against, of what we try everything that we want to do by way of programs and activities against. And if ever we become or do other than these things, we have gotten off track of having 2020 vision of God's church and ultimately off track of doing the will of God in and through His church. So these principles and purposes are what drive me as your pastor. They're what I hope for. They're what I pray for every day. And I would simply like to have our invitation time this morning, but with a little different focus. I would simply like to call us to a time of prayer regarding what the church is and what she does. I would encourage you to pray a few different things this morning. If you feel compelled to come to the altar, it's going to be an opportunity to do that. If you want to stay simply where you are, I simply urge that we all together pray along these lines. First, that we pray that our vision does not blur of what God's church is and does. That these things remain extremely clear when it comes to what we think about the church and what we desire for her to be doing. I would also encourage us to pray that God would motivate and empower every individual Christian in this church to embrace and engage these purposes. I encourage that we pray that God would guide our pastors and our church leaders in having the wisdom and discernment in knowing how to lead the church to carry out these purposes. And then finally, I encourage you to pray, know, I'm going to ask Pastor Dan to come, and this morning our invitation is going to be instrumental. We're not going to sing with our voices, but we want this to be a reflective time, and so I invite you to bow your heads and close your eyes, and if you feel compelled to come to the altar, you're more than welcome to do that. But I'm going to pray out loud, and then we're simply going to have an instrumental invitation this morning of reflection and prayer along 2020 vision for God's church. Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for clarity of what your church is and what it ought to be doing. I am so thankful, Lord, as a pastor in a local church, that I don't have to rely on myself to figure out what the church is and what she should do, but Lord, that you've put it in Scripture that is timeless, that it's true. This is what the Holy Spirit empowers the church for, Lord. And so, God, would you ingrain these principles and these purposes deep into our heart and mind this morning? God, when we think even just the simplest thought or most in-depth thought, when we reflect on what the church is and does, can these things be things that automatically come to heart and mind? But Lord, would they also be the things that we actually do as a church, Lord, from pastor and staff to every individual member of this church? Lord, we exist to glorify you and do your will, and we find it true that your will is to carry out the purposes